Hi, my name is Joe Cartwright. Welcome to my studio. My aim with these videos is to help you paint better watercolours. This next series is all about the basics. If you're a beginner or have found painting with watercolours challenging, then please join in as these videos are for you. And remember, if you like what you see, please subscribe and hit the notification bell so you'll be informed of each new video I produce. Also, if you have any questions or requests, please leave them in the comment section below. I read them all. Enjoy your painting. Hi, let's start with the materials we're going to need while we're doing this course together. So the first item is the paper. I use Arches paper, spelt A-R-C-H-E-S, and it's been made in France for hundreds of years. It's a warm white paper used by watercolorists around the world, very high quality, and they produce this paper in three different types, a rough textured one, medium texture, and a smooth texture. The one I use mainly is the medium texture, also known as cold press, but sometimes I also do use rough. The smooth paper I tend not to use. It's primarily used by people who do botanical art, and also graphic designers use it as well. When you're using or selecting watercolour paper, the main thing is the surface quality of the paper. You don't want paper that acts like blotting paper, because it just absorbs the paint very quickly and doesn't allow the paint to flow. And you'd like a paper that's reasonably tough so you can lift paint out of it without fear of damaging the paper. When you buy watercolour paper, it's in many different sizes. The most common size you buy is in a loose leaf, what they call a full sheet size, which is approximately 22 by 30 inches. And usually that's the format that I buy it in. Buy it in packs of 10, and then I cut it into quarters, which are generally known as quarter sheets, and that's about the size that I do most of my paintings. Double that size is what we call a half sheet, and obviously the full sheet is known as a full sheet. I paint in all sizes, but mostly in quarter sheet. For this course, however, as it's a course for absolute beginners, most of the actual paintings we do will be half of a quarter sheet, which will be an eighth sheet. The paper sits on a board. You want something that's stiff, reasonably light, but you can use anything from sealed plywood to Perspex will work. But what I really like is this material here. It's called gator board. It's basically a foam core sandwiched between two thin pieces of compressed timber. It's very light, and so I use it a lot when I'm traveling and painting outdoors, but it's also very stiff, which is great. For painting at home, a piece of plywood is fine. I just find plywood can be quite heavy when you're having to take it away for painting outdoors, or especially if you're traveling overseas. For this course, we'll mainly be taping the paper to our board, and for that you need some masking tape, which is about an inch wide, and half of which will be on the paper and half will stick to the board. With masking tape, you want it to be quite sticky. Some masking tapes have no real adhesiveness to them, and they don't keep the paper on the board pretty well, but you want one that's quite sticky, and it's very hard to show you in this, but it's on the video. But this is really quite a sticky masking tape. The other items we're going to need are, you'll need a palette, and you need a palette with paint wells that are quite large in size, so you can put plenty of paint in them, and you want a palette that has quite large mixing areas. The reason you need the large mixing area is because if you're going to paint big surface areas, then you need to mix lots of paint. A big mistake beginners make, they just mix tiny little dabs of paint, put one brush stroke, and then find they've got to mix some more. And that's really making it very hard for you, because by the time you try and mix some more, one, it's almost impossible to match the colour exactly, and two, it will dry. The paint you've already painted with is dried, and then you try to keep going back into that, and you can create what we call a muddy watercolour, which is a watercolour that's lost its translucency. So that's the palette. Palettes like this you can buy from Amazon. I prefer the ones that have at least three good size mixing areas. Now the paints we're going to be using to keep costs down for the next 10 weeks or so while we're doing this course together, I've limited it to just three tubes of paint. I've already talked about the size of the paper, so we're going to keep our sizes down, and we'll also only be using two brushes. My regular students who are in my advanced class, they use about 13 colours, and they have a range of about six or seven brushes, and obviously we also paint on bigger paper, so the costs can be quite significant, which is fine once you've decided, hey, watercolour is for you. But the idea behind this course is to give you a taste for what you can do with watercolour, learn about the basics, and then if you make a decision that you really want to stick to this, what I think is a wonderful medium, then you can move on and buy the rest of the materials. So for this course, the colours we're going to use are permanent rose, Windsor Blue Red Shade is also called a green shade. Windsor Blue Red Shade is the one you want. It's a blue, very transparent blue that leans a little bit to the red. And Windsor Lemon, which is what we call a cool yellow. Permanent Rose is what we call a cool red. It's a red with just a tiny bit of blue in it. So there's the colours. So these are the brushes. One of the problems with watercolour or watercolour brushes is there's no standard amongst brush manufacturers. So what is a size 12 in one manufacturer may not be a size 12 in another manufacturer. So basically these brushes, they're made by a Melbourne company called NEEF, N-E-E-F. They're not really available all around the world. So for anyone outside of Australia, it's probably easier for you just to source brushes that are similar. These particular brushes are a combination of squirrel hair and some sort of synthetic, probably talcon or something like that, and the combination allows the brush to hold lots of paint but also spring back to a nice point, which I'll talk more about in a minute. But anyway, the size of these brushes, so when you're looking for a brush, what you want, the size 12 brush has hairs that are sticking out of the ferrule. So this metal bit is called the ferrule. The hairs are sticking out about 29 millimetres. And at the ferrule, the diameter is about 8 millimetres. So that's really what you should look at to end up with a brush similar to what I'm going to be using in this course. And for the size 8 brush, at the ferrule it's about 5 millimetres. And the length of the hair is about 21 millimetres, right? So if you can find brushes like that, that'd be ideal. What you want in a good round watercolour brush is that when you dip it in water, tap it a couple of times, it bounces back to a nice point. And what that allows you to do is when you're painting, it allows you to paint detail and also larger washes or areas of paint, larger areas of paint quickly without having to keep picking up the paint. So these brushes, because of the squirrel hair, they hold lots of paint, and that minimises the number of brush strokes. Some of the items that will be useful in this course, one is a spray bottle. You need a spray bottle with a fine mist. Those trigger bottles are no good, they're just too forceful. A spray bottle like this is able to produce a very fine mist with a when it lands on your already wet surface, won't disturb the paint underneath and allow you to keep working longer. But I'll discuss more about how to use a spray bottle later in the course. Another item you need is an old towel. And what I use it for is to take moisture out of the brush, which allows me to control how much paint I have on the tip of my brush when I'm producing a particular brush stroke. I don't use it all the time, but I do use it quite often. You're also going to need a pencil, preferably one like this. It's a mechanical pencil with a 0.7mm HB lead inside. You can put multiple leads in there, and then you can go for, depending on how often you use them, but I've gone for months without having to put any more lead in them. Because it's a mechanical pencil, it's very predictable as to the point you get on it. So I would recommend one of those. If you do use a normal wood encased, you know, a wooden pencil, then you'll just have to be sharpening it quite regularly. And you'll need an eraser. So the best erasers for watercolour are these kneadable erasers. They're a little bit like blue tack, but please don't get blue tack. Blue tack has other chemicals in it and it will stain your paper. This is a very soft, as you can see, it's kneadable, a bit like when you're kneading dough to make bread. You buy them in a little rectangular packet like this. They're very inexpensive. Take the cellophane off and then maybe break it up in 2-3 pieces and put some away for later. And then you've got an eraser you can use, and they last for a long time. The main reason I prefer these is that they're very gentle on the paper and they don't produce any bits of vinyl or plastic like this type of eraser. And the problem with these is if you use them to rub out, they leave bits of plastic. You're just as likely to automatically brush them off and have those bits land in your paint. And if they get into your paint, especially if your paint's wet, you won't get them out, right? And then you'll find yourself painting and you think you've just, all you've got is paint in your brush, and those bits of plastic will just put lines in your paper and you could ruin a good painting. These hard erasers do have a use. I mainly use them when a painting's dry, and if there happens to be a particular pencil mark that's bugging me, I can usually get most of it out with one of these, all right? But you probably won't need it for this course. And you'll need a water container, usually, you know, something about this size will be fine, something that holds, you know, 1 or 2 pints of water. You also need something to hold your board at an angle of about 15 degrees. So that can either be a block of wood, a box of tissues, or if you like, a simple easel like this that you can rest your board on. So this angle's about 15 degrees, and that's really the main thing. You don't want it too much higher than that, because as you increase the angle of your board, the quicker the paint will flow down the paper. And unless you're very comfortable and experienced, that can make it a bit of a challenge, because the paint can run down the page into areas that you don't want any paint on. Don't try to take your paper directly to your easel, however, because you want to be able to pick up your board, and sometimes you want to be able to tip the board so that you can alter the direction that the watercolour flows in. If you tape it onto the easel, then you've got a much heavier object that you've got to try and manipulate, and that's not going to be easy. Now, the last ingredient is actually what's in here, which is water. And I'll talk to you more about water when we get onto the next section, which is looking at the types of edges that we can create and the types of shapes we can create with our round brushes and our watercolour mixtures. So see you soon for episode 2.